How have you been? I know for a fact that you enjoy your sleep, you enjoy your books. This lockdown period has given a lot of time for you to catch up on both of those.
Not really. I think, yes, I have been reading quite a bit, but it is also important that I maintain some kind of a routine. And I do spend time training, maintaining some standard of fitness, not entirely what I have been before the lockdown, but it is imperative that we at least do basic strength training during this period, so that as and when the lockdown eases out, we are not starting from ground zero.
Absolutely. I mean, that's something I think all of us have come to expect of you, Mithali. You're the marathon woman of women's cricket. But one of the most enduring images of Mithali Raj, or of any cricketer in fact, has been that of you reading Rumi, of all places, from the dressing room balcony during the World Cup. Is that something that you've done for a long time, and the world caught on to it rather late?
I think yes, that I've been doing for a lot of years now. With reading, I have developed because those days we traveled extensively via train. Train journeys are usually quite long,
right?
Sometimes 24 hours or more than that. So, what right. one can do and how much can one sleep, on those journeys. So, I used to carry quite a bit of books, and I used to read through the journey, and then I've carried that even into the game sometimes, because when you padded up and waiting for your turn to bat, and then the openers give you a great start playing half of those maybe 30 overs, and you're still padded up, so you're waiting for your turn. So what best you can do is I try and read, so that I don't develop the anxiety looking at, okay, now my turn is going to come and stuff like that, because it is usually waiting on the sidelines. Sometimes players can probably spend more focus or more energy. By the time you get onto the ground, you pretty much are premeditated to play in a certain way rather than playing according to the situation. So, which I didn't want it to do at that point of time. So, I thought this probably would be a best way for me to deal with those kind of situations. It worked for me.
Right. And what you also very helpfully did was also narrate some of those stories to a lot of your teammates. Did any one of those girls eventually catch on to your reading habits as well?
Well, some of them do. Some of them do carry books. But of course, we all vary in our taste in terms of a genre that what we would like to read into. Most of them are into the self-help books, because that's what usually the athletes would like to indulge in. In a sort of, it helps you to inspire, motivate, or sometimes when you're going through those rough patches, you tend to read stories and that inspire you. I think most of them are into that kind of a genre.
Right. And another interest of yours right from the childhood has been Bharatanatyam, of course. There was a pretty good chance that you would have in fact become a pretty good Bharatanatyam dancer by all accounts. Do you still keep in touch with those dancing routines?
Well, I have. I quit dance when I was in 10th standard, so I don't. After that, I have not really tried anywhere or any other platform to do that, because it's a classical dance, so there is, a set of rules that one needs to follow. Since I have not given Arangetam, so it wouldn't be appropriate for me to showcase or do any sort of steps elsewhere. So when I stopped after that, I've never really tried to do that anywhere else.
Right. And there was once this incident, right, where you had to take a train to go to Bangalore to play a cricket game. And then there was also the Margari season that was happening. So you also had to go to Chennai, and you opted for the former rather than the latter. Was that a huge dilemma at that point of time, choosing cricket over Bharatanatyam, or was that a very straightforward thing for you?
Because both were very different fields altogether. Dance, of course, is something that I naturally got inclined to, and the first thing that I enrolled myself, cricket happened later. But as a kid, what attracted me more towards cricket is, back in those days, to find your name in the newspaper is a big thing. of course now correct. Nobody really reads as much newspaper because everything is on social media. But to see your name, even if it is a smallest of small article, it used to make a lot of difference for, because I was a school kid, I was going to school. Yeah. So most of my own classmates would like, you know, today we read your name in the paper. And so those things really, interested me to continue playing cricket. And yes, it was a very difficult choice. Most of the time it was my dad or my parents took the decision that, you know, I should be continuing playing cricket because I was rapidly getting on the ladder. Like I was progressing quite fast. And dance, yes, it is more cultural, but then it had its own charm to it. And I had a lot of interest in dance too. But as a young kid, I found, getting my name in the paper was quite a bit of a thrill for me. So I thought, okay, let me give it a try. Let me go and play the tournaments.
But you always said that the secret to your longevity has been having no backup plan of sorts. Has that stayed even now? Is that the same even now, or do you have a backup plan?
Yeah, I think so. I pretty much think so, because when most of them ask me what I'm going to choose after retirement or what is my plan after retirement, honestly, I don't know. I have not really given it a thought. I'm usually the person, because that's how it has been in my house also. Like, you know, we just go with the flow. I mean, usually things. They would at some point have avenues. I'm sure there will be a lot of avenues, but it is at that point of time, in that moment, what I feel is good for me or which interests me is what I take it up. I don't really plan my I've never really planned my career, neither have I ever planned how my life would be, because if that was the case, cricket wouldn't have happened in the first place if the planning was there. So
spot on.
I think when you have a backup plan, in some ways you're kind of unconsciously giving a signal that, you know, okay, it might not work, so that's why I have a backup plan. So if you don't have a backup plan, you kind of know that, okay, I have nothing, so I might as well put everything that I have into this.
Yeah. Well, that's a very interesting way of looking at it. I mean, since you brought up family, I can't help but ask you about your early years growing up with your older brother, Mithun. What was it like, playing cricket along with him? And if I gather correctly, he also went to the St. John's Academy. What were those years like?
Yeah. See, unlike the rest of my teammates who at some point have played gully cricket or played with the boys on the streets in the backyard, I've never started that way. For me, it was straight away into a very professional setup. Because yes, my brother he played cricket until his school level, so I used to tag along with him early in the morning. And because it was exclusively boys camp, there was no girls in the camp, and I played more with of course boys of my age group, never with my brother. But it was a very professional setup, and the first time I held the bat was I was assisted by a professional coach. So I don't know if I should count my blessings that, you know, that kind of a setup I was brought into straight away. And it so happened that my brother quit after his death and I continued playing.
One of the most interesting ironies of life. But I mean, that's also something that probably needs to be factored in, the whole sexism that generally is pretty rampant in our society, and I'm sure you have all come up facing a lot of hard knocks in your life early on. Do you remember one any particular instance where you've had to encounter a very weird or a very nasty piece of sexism in your formative years as a cricketer, and overcome that and accomplish what you have?
I don't think I honestly don't remember the earlier years, because it's way back. I'm sure there would have been a lot of these kind of instances where probably my parents would have faced and not me, because they pretty much cocooned me from all the kind of negativities. But usually there have been some marginally or more of a subdued sort of situations where traveling in the train with those big kid bags. The first thing people would ask, is it a hockey team? Nobody would even ask whether it's a cricket team. And right. when you say them that, you know, no, 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 we play cricket. It's a cricket girls team. So they would like question us with, do you play? I'm sure you guys play with tennis ball because it's more softer. Otherwise, girls can't take the hard hit of the ball. Do yeah. things, do the rules change for y'all because you can't really clear the boundary line? Do you have small boundaries and smaller, where the distance between wickets is a smaller, in fact? So these things may not be, it may not really hit you as much because we were kids. But yeah. at some level now, if you go back in time and think, probably it is. But again, it is more of the out of ignorance that people ask because people have right. not really seen women's cricket on television. So I can't really blame them if they did have these kind of thoughts when they first right. hear about women's cricket back then in the 90s.
Right. And as far as Indian women's cricket is concerned, some of the earliest names that we remember, at least in the last 20 odd years, have been yours as well as Jhulan Goswami's. So in that sense, it's one, you're already put on a pedestal. It's a position of responsibility as well. But it's also a position, it's also a bit of a golden cage at times, right? Where you are almost, you know, saddled with certain responsibilities, even though you don't necessarily want them. How hard has that been, you know, coping with, and what are those challenges particularly?
Well, I think sometimes what happens is when I got into cricket, I wanted to play for India. So my goals were very much, I would say, individualistic. Yes, I want to score runs and make my team win. I wanted to do well and stuff like that. But once you play over a period of time, when you become the captain of the Indian team, there is, I wouldn't say added responsibility, but there is a different dimension which is added to it. Say like, sure. you know, now you're the leader. So you set an example. So whatever you do should be in a phase that, you know, tomorrow your own teammates are going to follow it. So you can't really go wrong anywhere. So even the experiences that had, the bad experiences I had, it was looked, I definitely look at it as a learning experience because nobody is born leader. Yeah. Everybody develops aspects of it through the journey.
Absolutely.
But sometimes the world is a little harsh with the kind of criticism that you face. And even back those days when we played in empty stadiums, yet there were criticisms from the same fraternity. But today, of course, a lot, everybody sees that, so everybody have a viewpoint about it. But I think that is also one way of accepting things, that the biggest thing which I dealt was acceptance, that yes, at some point these are the responsibility. Even if I don't want it, it is part of it. It's part of the role that I have now.
Right.
So
I mean,
that probably makes things maybe a tad easier to deal with. Yeah.
And Mithali, almost everyone that's followed your career or followed you at some level knows for a fact that you are incredibly articulate and very intelligent. But inevitably, there were always a lot of questions. When I was looking up a lot of your older interviews, there were lots of questions which otherwise I don't even have to specify those. But those are questions that you wouldn't necessarily ask a male cricketer about. How was it for you to, you know, cope with those questions early on? Because on the one hand, media coverage is something that's necessary. But on the other hand, you also, you know, are party to questions that are absolutely unrelated to cricket. So how did you have to deal with those?
Well, initially, I would get a bit irritable, which is very natural, I'm sure, but because not because I think in our country, especially in terms of media, other than the profession that they would like to write, they definitely want a lot more information about the athlete's personal life.
Right.
But where do you mark it? Where do you think you need to draw a line? Is that, you know, you can't really get into too personal questions, because even athlete at the end of the day is a human, and they would like to keep certain things quite personal, because a lot of our emotions is very personal. We wouldn't like to discuss or put it across to people. And but there are times when I have faced a few journalists who are bent upon asking you all those personal questions, and I probably have learned to, you know, duck it in some way. Yeah.
Yeah, you in fact have ducked it rather well over the years, going by all the interviews that I've seen. But the other thing is, of course, wish Leela ma'am a very happy Mother's Day on our behalf as well.
Yeah, sure.
And the other superstition that we have heard about her is that she never watches you on TV when you're actually playing live cricket. Apparently, she didn't even watch the 2017 final that you played against England. Is that true?
Yeah. She didn't.
Okay.
Because one is that initially, at the beginning of when the matches were televised, she did watch a couple of matches, and she's usually seeing how her daughter looks on television. Does she look bored and stuff like that? So that is how I think every mother would look. And but later on, I think when probably at some level, even she feels that you know, she when she sees me get out, or when she sees me get beaten, she doesn't digest it well. So she says, like, you know, might as well not see you bat, and not see you bat on television.
Right.
And like any what other mother, she is kind of reaching out to the God, that the God protects her daughter and her team and stuff like that.
But what is the routine for the others in the family? Do they actually stay glued to the TV, or do they have similar superstitions as well?
Well, I don't think, other than my dad, anybody is too keen to watch cricket matches on television.
Okay.
Even my brother. Because I think it has... because growing up, me and my brother were not allowed to watch television. We never really watched television much as kids. Maybe later, when we were in... college, that's when we actually got access to watching television. So we don't so that is a habit that we developed early in our lives, and so we don't really are not glued to television normally also. It's just that my dad is very passionate about cricket, like anybody else in our country. For everybody, cricket is like next to religion. So dad is pretty much watching all kind of matches on television, but other than him, I don't think anybody else, whether even my brother, doesn't watch much of cricket.
What are the earliest memories of a cricket match that you watched as a youngster? The first match that you remember watching?
1983 World Cup of Kapil Dev, the final game. Because that was pretty much played on a loop on that Doordarshan, because that's the only channel we had back then. So that is something when I started playing cricket. My dad made sure I'm watching that day in, day out to get inspired. And because when I started, initially I was an all-rounder. I was like opening bowler and an opening bat. So he wanted me to pretty much ape how Kapil Dev used to bowl fast bowling.
And how did you deal with your grandmother, your dad's mum, who perhaps saw your parents as sworn enemies, and they weren't necessarily too keen on you playing cricket? How did you deal with her? Did she eventually come around?
Well, I hardly, because we moved out quite early from the joint family, so I didn't really have that kind of an attachment with my grandmother. But yes, she definitely didn't want me playing sport. And but I think later on, slowly, when I started playing for India and there were a few articles in the paper, I think they then have come around. But I think it, as a Tamilian, like a Mudaliar family, it is very natural. Most of my cousins, you know, they are married quite early in life, like 22, 23. And so here I am playing a sport. So a little, a different path altogether that my parents have choose for me, and which at initially may not be of their liking, to my grandmother's liking. But I think... in terms of what they didn't like and how things were, probably it had a lot to do with my dad and my mother, because again, they were the ones who were taking a lot of that flak for putting me into the sport.
And the other interesting angle about your brother is that he's, of course, an environmentalist, works with NGOs like Samatha. Are you also passionate about certain social causes? If so, what are the causes that you really are most passionate about and closely support?
Well, I think somewhere because of him, because of the field that he's been, I associated myself to a lot of causes very early, much before even BCCI came into the picture, way back in 2006-7. I was made an ambassador for one of these campaigns of Girl Child in Hyderabad. And since then, I try and associate with these campaigns and activities. Because when my brother was doing a lot of projects in the interior and rural areas of India, especially into the smaller districts, he used to stay there. He did a lot of field work. And then when he comes back home, and then, you know, I'm discussing with my mother, like, you know, look at the road, what it is, or and stuff like that. So when we complain, he's the one who points out to us that we should be more, we are actually a privileged lot to have these kind of things. There are areas where there is no electricity, not even a path to walk. And I have seen so many people there living in such environment. So you should not be complaining. So we have somebody like that at home showing us the real picture. Then, you know, at some level you feel humbled, and then you would want to do something for those kind of people. So since then, we try and do in our own capacity what we can to help a little bit of those people.
Especially in the last decade or so, because you have become this huge star, and with the advent, with the proliferation of media as well, there's been thankfully greater coverage of women's cricket. Has it been easy for you to continue to lead a normal life, or has your life, you know, sort of changed beyond the ordinary?
I think post 2017, it did get a lot of it did get difficult, because I'm someone, not many understand that I have even seen, since I've seen the transformation in women's cricket and women's cricket in India, from days where we've played in local grounds with nobody turning up for the matches, like literally empty stadiums, to days where people recognize you with your face, recognize you when you walk on the streets, anywhere you go for shopping or restaurants. So for me, it was a little difficult to accept that. Maybe for young people like now, like Shefali, Jemima, who are coming in, the setup is already there. So they don't have to go through the transformation as much as I would have, because I've traveled in trains and today I travel in business class. There are times when I didn't even earn a penny playing women's cricket. Now I'm a centrally contracted player. So I have seen both sides of the coin. So for me to change my own lifestyle, my own perspectives of a lot of things, took a while. And it was difficult for me to also go through that change. And there is a good part about it, because as people, we like appreciation. We like the world, you know, validate what we do, acknowledge our hard work and everything. But at the same time, there are some aspects of your life that you would want to be cocooned or protected from the outer world. So now it is important how I try to balance that. So when I'm home, I try to do everything as normal as I can. And that's what my even my brother and my mother make me feel that way. If there are anything that I would want my maid to do, and she would like, no, you're doing it. You have been doing it. So you do it yourself. So I have people around like that. At times when you know unknowingly you're kind of flying, there are people to get you down on the ground. You need to have such people around.
Who, apart from your immediate family members, do that to you regularly? Are there friends in your cricket circle that also try and keep you grounded whenever they can?
Yes, I think I have quite a few friends that I do. I still maintain relationships with, friendships is with my under 19 players. Like, I played under 19, under 16s with. Most of them are married. But when I hang out with them, I feel like, you know, they don't look at me as the Mithali Raj or the star or the celebrity. Right. They look at me as one of their own. And that makes me really happy to be around them, enjoy their company, because I know they're not going to judge me for what I'm doing. Correct. And yes, I do have few friends. Like, I have Nushin, who's also an ex-international cricketer, India cricketer, who's played along with me. I have Prajita Bansal, who's a lawyer by profession, but she's also played under 19 and she's coached zone side. So I have these girls who I'm constantly in touch with, and who at times when I feel that, okay, I don't think this is the decision that I need to take. So if I'm clouded by any of my emotions, they are there to show me that, you know, you're not probably in the right frame of mind to take a decision. So probably I think that real that kind of people around, it helps me to take decisions and not depend on my emotional side to take the right kind of a decision. Because sometimes what happens is we are usually you know, if you don't control your emotions, you pretty much ride on it, and not necessarily right. Every time you're taking the right kind of a decision, keeping the bigger picture in mind.
Right. From someone who wasn't particularly fond of social media, wasn't very active on social media, you've gone on to become this person who's incredibly savvy and very comfortable with photo shoots and, you know, a lot of the endorsements that you do these days. How did that transformation happen, and at what point did you think that you are going to be good in front of the screen, you're going to be a lot more sociable and a lot more camera friendly?
Well, I think if you think I'm camera friendly and if you think that I enjoy doing those, then probably I'm actually better putting up a show then. I think so. Well, honestly, I'm really camera shy because
right.
I don't, I mean, it feels like, you know, somebody is pretty much invading the deepest side of me somewhere. I feel if okay. I'm doing the photo shoots and ads, but again, it comes to the same point that if I refuse or if I'm not doing it at some level, probably it will impact the brand of women's cricket somewhere. As you mentioned, since for years people have been following only 2-3 members of the team. So when people talk about women's cricket, it is very natural that our names are being taken. So if we are not doing certain things for whatever reasons, it probably may not reflect very well on the branding of women's cricket. So there are times when I've done only for that, but there are also times when I have taken up few things to understand that, you know, what, let me try a few things, because I'm someone who believes that you should try everything once at least to know if you have an inclination towards it or not. So social media, yes, initially I was not very keen because I hardly used to post anything. But as I'm
then your account got hacked.
Yes, my account got hacked right in the middle of the World Cup. And I'm really techno challenged. Okay, I really don't know how these things work. So I literally
are you still at techno challenged?
Yes, I am. Yes, I am. So I called a couple of my teammates who were actually working in the gym. I just asked them to come immediately sort this out, and then I reached out to the ICC. So thankfully it got sorted, but it was a little scary, and at times I felt like, I mean, what do people think? I mean, I hardly had followers back then, and they had to really hack my account of all, because there's hardly anything to hack into.
Right. But yeah, I mean, now you, I mean, clearly can flaunt with a lot of pride, 1.3 million followers on Instagram and counting for sure. The other thing is, you, of course, did release your autobiography, Unguarded, a couple of years ago. That's actually more in line with what you would probably do, right? That's more in the Mithali zone, right? Where you end up writing a book and, you know, where you basically make sure that people are also privy to certain things that otherwise they wouldn't have been.
I think of course, like as a centrally contracted player, I can't really come up with a book right now as a current player. But yes, that is something I'm looking into, and this is the period that I'm using to speak to my editor and get a lot of material going because. So because I want the book to. Be closer to what say most of the women cricketers have gone through, the kind of experience that, because see, after BCCI is coming in, pretty much everything is out there, everybody knows what has been happening. There is some part of it which is still documented in terms of statistics and matches going live, interviews, everything, but people don't know what went during the WCCI days. So maybe I'm one of those few who can actually get it out and tell the world that, you know, these were the most challenging times. This is what these players have gone through. And when people tell me, like, the current players, you know, they play really well. I also feel that there were ex-cricketers who were very stylish, some very amazing players like Neetu David, who's going to be my all-time favorite woman cricketer, but
absolutely
hardly people have seen how good she has been, like in her peak years or when she was bowling, because they were amazing cricketers even back then. It's just unfortunate the timing, or probably the time wasn't great, or we didn't have back then BCCI or the matches being televised. But I think that is something which I'm trying to get into my book. A lot of experiences of what went in those days.
And of course, Shabash Meethu happened eventually, a year or so down the line. How did that come about?
When we came back from the World Cup, of course, there were a lot of talks about doing a movie, and I was a little apprehensive because I didn't know whether this would happen or not and how things would go. But if you ask me honestly, I never thought that there would be a movie on my journey as a cricketer. But again, it is very relatable in terms of my book as well, because it is something, again, probably more... you know, shorter version of the book will be probably get to see on the screen. But I'm actually in a way happy that in some level women's cricket is being acknowledged by everybody. Absolutely. In India, and there is no more that ignorance about women's cricket or women cricketers in our country, which we faced back then. And I'm sure if, like, how Dangal or how Mary Kom's movie has inspired so many young girls to take up a profession which was not very inclined to women, I think my movie should also, or will be, inspiring a lot of young girls, because these days I see those videos on social media where very tiny tots, like literally 3-4 years kids, are holding the bat. They're literally the height of the bat and they are playing such beautiful strokes. So I think those kids should be inspired to see the journey of a woman cricketer and at some point dream of playing for India. And if that happens, like, nothing like it.
Oh, you have already done that, and I'm sure this movie is probably going to take that to the next level. But Tapsee, of course, did seem to be a little apprehensive about the fact that you would be monitoring her cover drives and how well she's going to execute those. How closely have you been in touch with her, and what are the kind of inputs that you keep sharing with her?
Well, I just told her that, you know, she has to work extra hard on the cover drive, because one is that obviously I want to put that fear in her a little bit to see whether she'll get rattled by it. And but I think she aced the picture of the movie with the hat and everything, because pretty much that's the detailing which goes in. And at some point, a lot of people have texted saying that, you know, we can't really make out if it is you or her on the picture, you know. So I think she pretty much will work on the kind of style that I play my skill, because that is what people would like to see, or closer to what I look on the field. And she will be probably monitored and coached by, of course, one of my closest friend, Nooshin, because Noosh has seen me even grow as a cricketer, and she knows pretty much all the small minute details of what I do when I'm training or when I'm trying to get into bat, all the superstitions of you know, wearing my left leg guard first, and all these things will come into. And if not for the lockdown, or if not for the current situation, probably she would have started her training by now.
Right. Have you had has she had a chance to shadow you, you know, just observe your lifestyle, keep tabs of what you're doing?
Well, I think it would be difficult for both of us, because obviously she's also a busy actress and she's been doing quite a bit of films. And even I was kind of, even though... I was not playing the T20 World Cup, but I was very busy as an ambassador for ICC. So even I was traveling a lot, and then we had our camps, fitness training and everything. So tailing me would be very difficult. So that is the reason why I think she actually got in my best friend to coach her in that sense. Yeah.
Right. Have you had a chance to look at any of the rushes so far?
No, I haven't.
Right. And just going back a little to the 2002 test match, a much younger Mithali Raj, you know, creating a world record, and then the 2005 World Cup runner-up appearance. And then when you compare that to the reception that you received in 2017 after the World Cup, how was it like back then in 2002 and 2005? Was there any spotlight at all?
Well, if you see, there were three stages to how I was being received. The first time when I was received was in 2002, when I broke the world record of 214 runs. And I traveled by train, so I reached Hyderabad by AP Express from Delhi. And I had so many people throng the platform, railway station. Right. And when the train got in, I was thinking, okay, there must be somebody who's very important who's coming today. That's why people, there are so many people. And then little did I realize that everybody there, were there only for me.
They were
and
there
the
for you,
time,
okay.
Of course, 2000, the second time was, of course, 2005. And but 2005 was a little different, is because I did have people at the airport who came and received me. But then when we came from South Africa to Mumbai, we hardly had anybody receiving us at the Mumbai airport. But that was very different to now 2017 World Cup, when actually the team arrived into India in Mumbai. Then we had so many people at the airport that it was a little difficult for me or for my teammates to walk out of the exit area. And it took literally an hour for us to walk maybe like a good 15-20 meters. So I think and a lot of people, and that was very odd time we came in. We came in probably early in the morning, quite early or midnight sometime, you know, very odd hours we arrived. And we had so many people at the airport. And then even in Hyderabad, when I was received, there was so much, like so many people came to receive me. So I think each time when we have come to a stage where runners up or world record, I think each time I've seen people come to receive me, it has only become bigger and bigger.
Right. One of the most curious things about Mithali Raj's career, even to those who have followed you closely, is the fact that you have said that you really haven't taken too much of a liking towards T20 cricket. And you obviously did retire from the international formats as well. And had you had the option of playing test cricket, you would probably not have played the formats at all. I mean, is there a reason why you haven't taken a liking towards the shortest format?
Well, one is that, see, I truly believe, even though today, if you say T20 is fast-paced and it also has its own charm, but it also has its own challenges that a player faces. But again, test is something is the ultimate challenge. Test in itself, it is, test players' every ability, just not about your skill, your mental, your strategies, your temperament, everything it tests. And honestly, seeing 200 plus ODIs that I've played, compared to the 10 test matches that I've played, somewhere I feel that, you know, wish I could have played a lot more. Because even a normal man, a common man, when he interacts with you, the first thing they'll ask is, how many test games have you played? That's the first thing anybody will ask. Nobody asks you how many one days you played or how many T20s you played. The first thing they'll ask you, how many test caps you have. So, people relate to the test match as the pinnacle of format of cricket. And so I would have loved to play as a cricketer or as a player. I would have loved to play more test matches to see how better or how good I am as a player. But again, I came into a time when test matches were fading and the one days were actually the format that cricket was running on. And then later in my stages was when T20 came in. And now T20 is a vehicle that ICC is taken to promote women's cricket globally. So, the test matches and the T20 have come like kind of in the first and the last stages of my career. But one day is something I've played throughout my career, and that is why I think I'm pretty much quite happy in the way that I've turned out as a one-day cricketer. And I also believe 50 overs is something where there is situations like a test match where you have to hold on to one end and get through. And there is also cases where, as you go in, you will have to play like a T20, just, throw your bat here and then get as many runs as you can in the death overs. So it's a culmination of both the formats in one format. And that is why probably I have a liking to the one day format, and I've played more one day matches. And that is
the reason runs.
Yeah, so I think maybe I don't have that kind of an attraction towards the T20 format.
It's interesting you say that, because you've also been a very strong advocate of the women's IPL, and you've also played in those T20 challenge games. Do we actually get to see Mithali Raj should a women's IPL in fact eventually take place?
Well, Well, you never know, because I'm still playing and I would love to be part of a setup like an IPL. If it happens in the near future, maybe next year, yes, definitely I would love to play at least one season. Because it is something which is happening in India, so I would like to be part of it and see how things go. Because at the end of the day, if you're having a setup like that, you would want your best national players to be part of it, to get people to watch it. So in that sense, yes, I definitely would love to be part of it and see more youngsters coming out of that tournament who are going eventually playing for India.
Speaking of youngsters, of course, the 2020 World T20, which eventually, which concluded a few months ago, did create a lot of noise for all the right reasons. It had the buzz that you would expect a world event to have. Is it like, in a way, the golden period for women's cricket? Just looking at the sheer euphoria, the kind of attention that was cast upon the tournament?
I think women's cricket started to grow and at a faster pace from say 2017, because that's when I think things really changed. From the 2017 World Cup, the kind of marketing that ICC has done, as soon as the Champions Trophy got over, I could see, actually, when I was watching the Champions Trophy matches, I saw this huge hoardings where they have put on all the team captains, and in a way trying to tell people that the next big tournament is a Women's One Day World Cup. And as players and as all teams try to give the best kind of cricket for all the viewers, so that they really enjoyed every game that has been played during that tournament, and there were some games which went for 300 plus score. So I think from then on, I think it's just not about women's cricket in India or Indian women cricketers' profile, but overall, if you see, a lot of people are now going beyond one or two players in a side. People don't know a lot of other foreign players. So when a journalist asked me way back in 2000, I remember 2011-12, asking me if IPL should happen for women's cricket, then I said no, because obviously people don't know beyond 2-3 national players. They don't even know the entire Indian team. So I don't think it would be appropriate to have an IPL back then. But now I would say yes, is because everybody, even you probably would know few South African players, pretty much Australian players or England players. So I think when the profile of the players is increasing and is growing, so is the brand of the sport. And then it makes it easier to conduct a tournament like IPL now, because the T20 World Cup, which just finished in early this year, has actually got a lot of people to follow it also. I mean, just not people who turned up to the stadium, but I heard the viewership of that match has really crossed, has probably broken some records. So I think that itself is a good feedback that people are ready to see women's cricket and are ready to, spend money and come and watch it in the stadium.
The other interest area of yours, gathering by your past experiences, has been mentoring, of course. That's something that you're very strongly spoken about, mentoring as well as the psychological aspect of the game. Do you consciously seek out younger talent in your teams and speak to them on these aspects? Who are the girls that you've kind of taken under your wing?
Well, not necessarily as a captain, I can't really take only a certain section of the players under the wing. Probably it might show, the bias or... So what I try and do is try and help every player and reach out to the players who I think find it a little difficult to, find difficult to go through certain situations. So there are some players like me who are kind of introvert and try and deal with the situation by themselves. So as someone who have already been in those times, I try and give my own suggestion, and if it helps them, good enough. Otherwise, obviously, they will try and seek advice from other quarters. But I think it is important in today's time, especially when you have so much of distractions and social media is one of the biggest thing, that you need mentors around, or you need your parents to play that role, to have those people around to show you how to balance things out. Because young girls, it is quite nice to be on social media and get a lot of likes and followers, but then at the end of the day, you don't you want to remember that, you know, you're an athlete and people would want to see you on the field of play, playing and performing. And that probably is most important.
Right. And during the Women's World T20, of course, from an Indian context, we have seen the Indian bowling contingent doing a terrific job. And youngsters like Shefali Verma also came of age at that point of time. So were you just looking at youngsters like Shefali? Who are the other youngsters that have caught your eye?
Well, I think Shefali is good. Of course, she was the find of the Challengers Trophy that we played last year, and that's how she got into the team. And we do have Sushri Pradhan, who is also a good off spinner. There are a few players who are into India A and emerging teams who've gone to Bangladesh. But again, there is talent. Of course, there is no dearth of it. We do have a lot of talent around. But they are raw talent. It needs to be molded. Even Shefali, of course, she's loaded with talent. But there needs to be a little work to be done in terms of her temperament. Because she's young. And any young kid or young player needs exposure, needs matches to learn, experience things on their own firsthand. That's how they will grow. So the more matches they play, the better they get.
Right. And just going back to the 2017 World Cup semi-finals, when you had to play on an empty stomach. It was a rain curtail game, of course, and all of a sudden you just had to get a move on and start playing on an empty stomach. What was that like? Were there any pre-game jitters of sorts?
We did have, I would, if I say we didn't have jitters, I would be lying. I had jitters every match before every game. The World Cup itself is like, you know, that platform gives pressure to any cricketer in the world. So it is very natural. No matter how many World Cups I've played, World Cup itself gets its own pressures and expectations. And every match, I would get the jitters going into toss. But we know that, you know, semi-finals or the finals, usually you know that today is a day that, you know, you one game and you're closer to the final. So we knew that was the semi-final and we were up against Australia. And when it was raining, I definitely did pray because I wanted a full game. I didn't wanted a cut short format like 2020 because at that point of time, we were still not very good in the T20 format. And I felt that we have a better chance if we have more overs because we are more of a one-day team. In 2017. So, I thought we should not play anywhere less than 40 overs. So, that is what I was aiming at. And luckily for us, we did get more overs to play. And I think every player realized that the importance of that day, the importance of the match. And of course, you know, you can't deny the fact that, you know, when your stomach is grumbling and you know that, you know, you need to eat few things. But I guess our physio and the manager did play a role in getting us all those little snacks here and there to, you know, keep munching and keep ourselves focused. Because, you know, usually the rain curtailed matches are the ones the players don't like because you don't know how things might turn up and how, you know, when suddenly with proper warm-up, you have to get onto the field. So, usually players don't like that. But again, given the facts, we had more overs and we wanted to get through.
Right. And in about a year's time, again, there is another big 50-over World Cup coming up. And that certainly, of course, does occupy a huge amount of significance for you. How much of planning has already gone into Mithali Raj's mind space as far as this big tournament is concerned?
Honestly, right now I'm not really thinking about preparation for the One Day World Cup because cricket is an outdoor sport, and right now everybody are indoors. We are confined to our homes, our houses, and we do have limitations in terms of the space that we have. And I think as and when the lockdown eases or when we are able to go on the ground, do a lot of groundwork, that is when I will start seeing or probably have a fair idea how much window that I have in terms of my preparation and how do I go about it. Because it's just not about skill preparation, it is even about fitness. Because when you're not training, I mean, I cannot forget how I bat. Maybe I need few throwdowns or maybe few sessions to get back into that rhythm. But what will take more hard work is to get my fitness to the level that it was prior to the lockdown. And Correct. That is pretty much the case with every athlete around the world, because if you're not training for even for 2-3 weeks, the first thing which is something which affects is your fitness. And it takes, you know, more than those days that you haven't trained to get back to that level that you've been. So that is something we all need to address, or maybe we'll that is the first thing that we will address.
Speaking of fitness, how much have things changed on the fitness front as far as the Indian women's team is concerned? I'm sure there's been a drastic amount of transition from the time you started out. But what are the areas that you feel the biggest changes have come about as far as fitness is concerned?
I think the girls have become more agile, because earlier we didn't have trainers back then. We didn't know how we need to train ourselves. The first thing now, coming under BCCI and having regular camps at NCA, where the trainers and the physios address a lot of issues in terms of if you're injured, how you can still continue training and also doing your rehabs to recover from the injury. There are different, like say for the fast bowlers, there's a different way of training. For a batter, there's a different. So it is more sorted sort of fitness training that all of us do. And in times like this also, we are constantly in touch with our team trainer to assist us. In, like, you know, because I stay in an apartment, so how I can use the crops in my house to do the basic training that I can. And he's the one who tries and gives us programs. So we are at least doing some kind of a physical activity indoors to keep ourselves healthy, to keep the muscles also at least workable. And if you're doing some form of exercises, even mentally, you kind of it helps you to calm down and get through the period that we are in.
Right. And also, given that in women's cricket these days, the number of matches, the frequency of matches is a lot higher than what it used to be. Surely there are opportunities to build friendships from across the world, and also during the Women's T20 Challenge. Who are some of your good friends from, across the cricketing sphere?
Well, I have... I'm not someone who usually tries to be in touch with everybody, even my
You're
own
You're an introvert, aren't you?
Yeah, even at home, like in Hyderabad, my own schoolmate who I've been, she's the only schoolmate that I've been friends with. I hardly speak to her maybe once or twice in a month. So I'm not someone who would like on a constant basis be in touch. But yes, I've been, I know a few people and I try and, speak to them, couple of them from New Zealand and... maybe one or two from West Indies. So I guess that's how you whenever you meet them, you probably go out, have a dinner, have a drink, and then that is it. It's like, you know, I try to be friendly on tour, and then when I'm back home, then it is back to the normal routine that we follow. Yeah. But I think
who are the members
media,
of the opposition that you have admired the most? I'm sorry, go on.
No, I just meant that, you know, having social media and, internet in terms of like Twitter and everything, it's easier these days to drop a text and find out how one is across the globe. And the opponents that I've admired the most is, of course, Karen Ralton. She's one of my evergreen favorites from Australia, a left-hand bat. Yeah. And I don't know, I keep thinking why I have this. Both my favorite players are left. One is a left-arm spinner, Neetu David, and the other one is a left-hand bat. So both are left-handers.
And you turned out to be right-handed.
Yeah, I turned out to be a right-hander. But I think Karen Ralton, she's one batter I would love to play with. Never got an opportunity. Had IPL sort of a thing happened back then, maybe I would probably put myself or recommend my name into the team that she would be in to just have a game. But yes, she's one of those players who I've admired playing against. And of course, Belinda Clark as a captain for Australia. Somebody I have truly looked up to. Yeah.
Right. And just one last question before we let you go, Mithali. The name Mithali in itself sounds rather unusual. I mean, like you yourself put it, I mean, coming from a South Indian family, it's a name that you don't normally associate with many South Indian families. So what's the secret behind your name? Was there a reason why you were named Mithali?
I think because when my mother actually wanted a girl, her firstborn should be a girl. So she already thought about Mithali because she was working in, dad being from Air Force. So we were probably for a few years, we were in Jodhpur. And so she was working in the tourism department. And so she probably had few Bengali friends and she liked that name. And my brother happened to be the firstborn, so she immediately had to change and get the name closer to Mithali. So that's how she named my brother as Mithun. And Mithun Chakravarty was a was kind of a rave back then.
Yes, he was.
He was a superstar. So like that's
disco
how
disco dancer, yes.
Mithali. Yeah.
Interesting choice of names. Just as how as interesting as how your career has panned out, Mithali. I mean, without any exaggeration, it's fair to say that you've been a super duper role model for millions and billions of Indians. You've been a real rock star as far as the whole sporting ecosystem has been concerned. Long may your tribe grow, Mithali. Wishing you the very best of luck and hoping to see plenty more of you on the field and hopefully in the broadcasting and the mentoring space as well. Not immediately, but in a few years' time too.
Yes. I'm sure. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Mithali. Thank you so much. Yeah. Great having you with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.